ओके, लेट्स कंटिन्यू. इन द लास्ट सेशन वी फिनिश्ड दैट इंट्रोडक्टरी पार्ट एंड देन वी स्टार्टेड विद यूनिट नंबर 1 दैट इज बेस्ड ऑन एब्रेसिव मशीनिंग एंड सम फिनिशिंग ऑपरेशंस. वी कंटिन्यू विद द ऑब्जेक्टिव्स, देन वी discuss this introductory part, what are the capabilities of the abrasive machining processes that we discussed, typical parts made, and what are the alternative processes that are available or that could replace these abrasive machining processes, that also we discussed. Then types of abrasives, the abrasives that you can get in nature in raw form that has got certain limitations. And to overcome those limitations, some abrasives are manufactured synthetically, and those artificial or synthetic abrasives has got two categories. One is conventional and then super abrasives. That also we discussed. Now, after talking about the types of abrasive, today we are going to continue with the properties of the abrasives, what properties abrasives are supposed to possess, or how those properties are going to affect the overall performance of the process, that we are going to discuss. So the first property that plays a important role in selection of any abrasive is the hardness. Now in MP1, while talking about the material removal processes, you must have discussed that if this is a workpiece and this is a cutting tool, if I am using this cutting tool to remove the material from this workpiece, the first condition that has to be satisfied, there are 3-4 conditions. The first condition that has to be satisfied is the cutting tool must be harder than the workpiece material. That is the first requirement. Then second is that a direct contact between cutting tool and workpiece, then relative motion between those two. But the first requirement is the cutting tool has to be harder than the workpiece material. Then only this tool will act as a tool, or else what will happen, there would be a reverse scenario. Instead of material being removed from the work surface, there would be erosion of the work material from tool itself if the cutting tool is softer than work material, right? So the first condition is or first characteristic is hardness. Then second is friability. Now friability is the ability of abrasive grain to fracture. Ability of abrasive grain to fracture. Now I'm using abrasive as a cutting tool, then what we expect from that cutting tool, it should not break, it should remove material from the material or the workpiece, right? That is what we expect from the cutting tool. Then why we are talking about this ability of the abrasive grain to fracture? The reason is, suppose this is a grinding wheel that has got one cutting point over here. We know that abrasives are going to have irregular shape, irregular size and all, right? So suppose this is abrasive that is popping out of the grinding wheel, and when this grinding wheel is rotated and move relative to this workpiece surface, suppose this is workpiece, then this abrasive is going to act as a cutting tool, okay? Now suppose you use for a while and gradually this abrasive is going to be worn out. So suppose this much layer is gone, this much layer is gone, and gradually what will happen, the projected surface of the abrasive that is outside the grinding wheel periphery will disappear, and there would be one flat surface on the grinding wheel. Now in that case, if I continue using this grinding wheel, what will happen? There would not be a material removal, and instead of that, there will be a rubbing between the grinding wheel and workpiece, and that rubbing will cause increase in temperature. And increase in temperature has got its own drawbacks, right? So to avoid that, what is expected once that cutting edge of the abrasive is gone, that abrasive should break. Means if initially abrasive has got this kind of shape, this is grinding wheel and this is the abrasive. While machining, suppose this much layer is gone. Now, suppose it has got developed a flat surface and it is not able to remove material with that abrasive. Then what we expect? We expect that it should break in some orientation. Let it be in any orientation, but this abrasive should break. And what will happen if that abrasive breaks in some orientation? You will get some pointed edge on that abrasive, and that edge will act as a cutting tool now, right? So that ability of abrasive to break is nothing but the friability. Now that friability value should be optimum one. It should not be too friable, or it should not be less friable also. If it is less friable, then what will happen? Even when the cutting edge of that abrasive is gone, it won't break. And if that flat surface is there that is going to rub against the work surface, it will unnecessarily increase the temperature. It is going to deteriorate the surface quality of work surface also. So to avoid that one, it is expected that it should break. Okay. So if it is less friable, that is also not desirable because it won't break. And extremely friable is also not desirable. Then what will happen? Even under small loading condition, the abrasive will break. And that way, the wear rate of grinding wheel will increase drastically. And that is also not desirable, right? So depending upon the material that you are machining, the condition under which that grinding wheel is used, accordingly, this friability value has to be considered, and accordingly the grinding wheel has to be chosen. Next, shape and size of the abrasive grain. Now abrasives are going to have random shape and size, but if abrasive is small enough, what will happen? And if abrasive is large enough, what will happen? These two are going to decide the friability of the abrasive. If abrasive is too small, or before discussing this one, I'll give you one example. If suppose this is a chalk, a new chalk, that has not broken, right? This is new one, having its full length. Now, if I want to break this chalk, I hold at this end and this end, and I try to twist it. I can break it easily, right? Now, if I take this half part and I want to break it, again, I hold it over here, and try to twist it. Somehow, I broke it, then I got this even smaller version. Now, if I compare the amount of force required in case one, when it was intact, the force required in second case, when it was almost half of the original size, then quarter of the original size, I can easily predict that the force requirement is going to increase in this direction, right? As you keep reducing size of the chalk, to break that chalk into two parts, the amount of force required is going to increase. And same thing would be applicable to abrasives also. So if abrasive is too small, the friability value will drop. And if abrasive is large the friability value will increase. So accordingly, we need to choose the size of the abrasive. Okay, next, grit number. The size of abrasive is denoted with the help of this grit number. You might have idea about this grit number. Grit number is nothing but if I take this area and this one. Even if you don't find those two similar, but consider that area of those two is same. Okay, suppose this is A1, this is A2. If I divide this area into, suppose those are like 40 divisions, and if I divide this area into 80 divisions, this 40 is nothing but the grit number, this 80 is nothing but the grit number. Now if I use this sieve for filtration, means if I pour some sand on this sieve, the sand that will pass through this sieve and the sand that will pass through this sieve, if I want to compare the particle size, which one is going to be larger, A1 or A2?
A2.
A2. A2 would be larger.
A2 will be smaller.
A2 would be smaller, right? Because the area of the sieve is same, but the number of openings are twice. So directly I can say that A2 is going to be half of the A1. Okay, so that way, if this grit number is larger, the particle size is going to be smaller. And if grit number is smaller, the particle size is going to be larger. Okay, so that way, from the value of grit number, you can identify whether the particle is large or small enough. And usually when you talk about the materials that are available in powder form, and if you want to know their particle size, that will be denoted with the help of this grit number. If you go to market and ask powder size, they will talk in terms of grit number. So that according to that grit number, you can identify what particle size it would be. Next, the next point that we are going to discuss is abrasive workpiece compatibility. Now, compatibility in the sense we need to consider the chemical affinity between the tool and workpiece material. From this term chemical affinity, we can easily predict that if chemical affinity is more, it means there is more possibility of a chemical reaction that would take place between the tool and workpiece. And if that chemical affinity is less, most probably there would not be any reaction even at elevated temperature. So this chemical affinity between abrasive particle and work material, that we need to consider while selecting the abrasive. If that chemical affinity is very less, the wear rate of the grinding wheel would be very less. If chemical affinity is less, wear rate would be less. But we know that this wear rate has to be in optimum condition. If wear rate is very less, even when that abrasive particle has lost its cutting edge, it will still remain there and it is going to affect the machining performance adversely. And even if that chemical affinity is more, that will increase the wear rate drastically. And if that wear rate is too high, the maintaining dimensional tolerances or accuracy would be very difficult. Okay, so that way we need to take into account the workpiece and abrasive compatibility. The best example for this one is, we know that diamond is one of the hardest material available out there, but diamond will never be used to machine this steel. The reason is the chemical affinity between diamond and steel. If you use diamond to machine this steel at elevated temperature, there will be a spontaneous reaction between those two, and instead of removing material from the steel, diamond itself start dissolving. And because of that one, diamond never used to machine the steels. That is the one of the example of the abrasive and workpiece compatibility. So which abrasive should be used for which material, that you will find over here. If you are talking about aluminium oxide, the materials are carbon steel, ferrous alloys and alloy steels. If it is silicon carbide, you can go for non-ferrous metals, cast irons, carbide, ceramic, glass and marble. If it is CBM, you can machine steels, cast irons, and when hardness is above 50 HRC, means more hard materials are there, then you can go for CBM. And if diamond is there, you can go for ceramic, cemented, carbides and some hardened steels, not all. Some hardened steels where that reaction is not that extent. Okay, in that case, you can go for the diamond also. Grinding wheels. Now we know that abrasive is nothing but a small irregular tool or cutting tool that has some random geometry, random shape, random dimensions. And when you use that abrasive as a cutting tool, that is going to remove material from the work surface that is further smaller than the size of abrasive. That is but obvious, right? If you are using it as a cutting tool, the material that would be removed by that cutting tool is going to be smaller than its own size. So if you are using small abrasive as a cutting tool and removing material using that abrasive, the material removal rate is going to be very small. Now if I want to improve that machining rate, what I need to do, instead of using single abrasive at once, I need to combine multiple abrasives together that will act simultaneously and remove a large amount of material that would improve the material removal rate. And to achieve this, what we do, we create grinding wheels. So grinding wheel is nothing but we take some abrasive particles, we mix them with binding material, we shape them into desired dimensions and characteristics, and then we use that wheel as a cutting tool. Okay. Now, the grinding wheel has certain characteristics that would be dependent of bond, grain and arrangement of those two, bonding material and grain. We will discuss all those characteristics while talking about the grinding wheel designation system. Before that, these are some of the examples of grinding wheel. There are n number of grinding wheels out there. I have mentioned few of them. You can find the types of grinding wheels that you can find in the market. these wheels are going to be applicable to various applications. Some of them are going to be applied to some specific applications. Some are like general grinding wheels, like this disc is there, then straight cup is there, the cylindrical wheel is there. These are going to have some general applications, or some, and some are going to have some specific applications also. Now, the characteristics that going to decide the application of grinding wheel that are based on this gauge, we will discuss over here. The marking system used for a grinding wheel. Now we know that there are two types of the abrasives. One is conventional and another one is super abrasives. So there is one marking system that is used for conventional abrasives. Conventional abrasives are aluminium oxide and silicon carbide, and there is another marking system that is used for CBN and diamond, that are the super abrasives. So let's begin with the conventional abrasive system. So when you go to the market to procure a grinding wheel, you need to know this combination of alphanumeric values. There are certain numbers, certain alphabets arranged in some particular fashion. That individual number and alphabet talks something about that particular grinding wheel. And from these numbers and alphabets, you can get the characteristics of the grinding wheels, and you can choose a grinding wheel for your desired application. So what characteristics are there in this designation or marking system? There would be digits at the beginning as well as digits at the end. Now, some manufacturers will provide some value at the beginning as well as end in the place of this digit. Some manufacturers may not. So this is going to be optional one. Okay, but if those numbers are there, those numbers will help you to understand or to find the applicability of that particular grinding wheel. To which application you can use that grinding wheel, that you will get from those two numbers. After the first number, there is alphabet. That alphabet will help you to get which abrasive is used to make that grinding wheel. This marking system is used for aluminium oxide and silicon carbide. So if A is there, it means abrasive is aluminium oxide. If C is there, abrasive is silicon carbide. After that alphabet, there would be a number. That number is indicating the abrasive grain size. Abrasive grain size will have four categories: coarse, medium, fine, and very fine. If that grain size in the range of 8 to 24, that would be coarse. 30 to 60, that would be medium. If it is in between 70 to 180, fine. And 220 to 600, it is very fine. Again, when you are talking about abrasive grain size, we are supposed to refer the grit number. You can see that if grit number is small, abrasive is coarse. And as you keep on increasing the grit number, the particle size is getting smaller and smaller. Okay. Now, the machining performance for those sizes would be, if you are using coarse grain, the amount of material removed by single abrasive would be more. But we know that if grain is larger, the friability value will also be larger. If you go to medium, those material removal rate and friability value keep on changing. So according to application, we need to choose this abrasive grain size. Second, will after that there would be one alphabet that indicating the grade. Grade is nothing but the strength of the wheel, and that strength is nothing but bond strength. Bond strength means we know that to create the abrasive, grinding wheel, abrasives are bonded together with some bonding material. And the strength of this bonding material or strength of the bond that is holding the abrasives together, that is nothing but the grade of the wheel. If that strength is small or strength is less, the wheel is soft. If strength is more, the wheel is hard. Okay, it would be indicated through these alphabets A to Z. Somewhere here at the middle, it would be medium. If you shift towards the right hand side, the hardness will increase. If you shift towards the left hand side, softness will increase. Now, whether we should go for soft wheels or should we go for hard wheels? Soft wheels means they can wear out easily. Hard wheels means the wear rate is going to be very small. Now, if you are machining a soft material and if you are machining a hard material, which type of wheel should we use? If I am machining soft material, I have to go for hard wheels. And when I am machining hard material, I have to go for soft wheels. It's the reason behind that, if I am machining hard material and I am using hard wheel only, what will happen? When I am using hard wheel, the abrasives on the wheel surface will worn out easily because the work material is hard. And after that, what is expected? If this is a grinding wheel that has got one abrasive over here, this abrasive is worn out. After that, either this abrasive should be logged out the wheel, or there should be removal of some layer on the grinding wheel so that some abrasives that are inside the grinding wheel, because the whole thing is made up of abrasives and binding material, right? So if I remove one layer from the wheel surface, some fresh abrasives will be visible, and those abrasives will now act as a cutting tool. And if that breaking of layer or breaking of bond is not possible, the machining will become inefficient, and that will happen when you machine hard work material with hard wheel, because hard wheel means this breaking of abrasives and breaking bond will be less frequent in case of hard wheel, whereas in case of soft wheel that would be more. So if you machine hard material with soft wheel, what will happen? The abrasive will remove whatever material that possible to it, and after that the either abrasive will come out of the wheel surface or one layer will be gone from the wheel surface, and there will be availability of fresh abrasives, and that will act as a cutting tool for further machining. So accordingly, we need to choose the abrasive from the soft and hard wheels. The next one is structure. A number that is going to indicate the structure. Number will be varying from 1 to 16, and it can be extended further. Less number, the structure is dense. Dense means a large number of abrasives inside the grinding wheel. If this is the wheel surface and that has got a large number of abrasives very closely arranged, the structure is dense, and when the number of abrasives are less and they are separated with a large space, the structure is open. Now we know that if I am using single abrasive, material removal rate is going to be very small. And to increase that material removal rate, what we are doing, we are combining a large number of abrasives together that will act simultaneously, and material removal rate will be improved. But still, using dense wheel will not be a choice. What will happen if this is a grinding wheel and there is one abrasive? This is the work material from which the material is to be removed. This is workpiece. Now when these two are going to have relative motion against each other, this abrasive will come in contact with this work surface and it will remove the some amount of work material from here. Now while removing that material, there will be a formation of chip. That chip will flow along this abrasive and then will be separated from the work surface. Now suppose very next to that abrasive I placed another abrasive. Now what will happen? The chip formation that is expected to happen with this abrasive one will be the obstacles will be created by this another abrasive for the chip formation by first abrasive. This will happen when you go for the dense wheel. And even when there are a large number of abrasives are there, still machining removal or material removal rate will drop, because abrasives are creating obstacles to each other for the chip formation. Whereas if you go for the open wheel, it is but obvious that if abrasives are very small in numbers, the material removal rate is going to drop. So again, we need to have some optimum value. The next thing, bond type. Bond type is simply a bonding material that is used to hold the abrasives together. The examples could be resinoid, resinoid reinforced, shellac, oxychloride, rubber, silicate, vitrified, and additionally, a few more types of bonds are there that are applicable to super abrasives only. But for conventional abrasives, these are the types of bonds available. Okay, so this is the marking system, and various alphabets and numbers refer to. Now, next marking system is for super abrasive, that is for CBN and diamond. Now, this is a little bit different from the conventional abrasive one. It starts with alphabet, that is manufacturer symbol, and indicating the type of diamond. Next would be abrasive type. So this first digit would be there if that is diamond B, or else next would be abrasive type. If B letter is there, that means CBN is the abrasive. If D is there, diamond. Next would be green size, grid size, that is varying from 20 to 1000. Smaller the grid size, larger the abrasive. Larger the grid size, smaller the abrasives. Next, alphabet, grade, again A to Z. A means soft, Z means hard. Then diamond concentration. This point was there, but in terms of structure, dense and open. This is for conventional abrasives, whereas in case of super abrasives, it is called, or it is used as a diamond concentration. There are four ranges, 25, 50, 75 and 100. As we know, diamond and CBN both are going to be much costlier than the conventional abrasives. So those abrasives are used in some predefined concentrations. So that concentration ranges from 25 to 100. Next, type of bond. In case of super abrasive, there are only three types of bond. metal vitrified, and in some cases resinoid. But most prominently, metal and vitrified bonds would be there. Then bond modification means if this bonding material has been combined with some additional material to improve the bond or to make it suitable for. Okay, let's continue. So we were talking about this marking system used for super abrasives, that is CBN and diamond. So we were discussing this bond modification. We talked about bond in previous all points. Bond modifications in the sense, if you have modified that bonding material, whether it is resinoid, metal or vitrified one, if you have modified that bonding material to make it suitable for certain applications, then that modification will be mentioned in the marking system of that grinding wheel itself. And the last one would be a fraction number that indicates the depth of the diamond in terms of inches. Depth of the diamond means if you are making wheel out of these super abrasives, suppose this is a diameter of the actual wheel when you got it from the market. Okay, you started using this grinding wheel to remove material from the work surface. It is obvious that after a certain period of use, it is going to worn out and its diameter is going to be decrease and decrease, right? After certain use, suppose this wheel has got reduced to this much diameter, and for that particular application or in any application, if situation is like once it has got reduced below a certain diameter, you cannot use it. Then what we need to do, you just need to discard the wheel. We just need to throw it out, right? But imagine if that whole wheel is made up of super abrasives, whether it is CBN or a diamond, that are costliest one, and throwing that wheel which still has some abrasives in it. And if you are throwing it out, that is not going to be affordable all the time. So to avoid that, when wheels are made up of these super abrasives, what we do, instead of making complete wheel filled with abrasives and bonding material, the some portion of that wheel will be made up of supporting material, usually that is metal, and after that certain diameters, the additional layers that are going to get you the actual diameter of the wheel, in this region it will be a combination of abrasives and bonding material. So once this material is worn out till this range, you can discard this wheel without worrying about the cost, because that part is made up of the metal. Okay, so this depth is nothing but the depth of that abrasives indicated by this last number, that is in terms of inches. So till what depth abrasives are there, and below that the supporting material is there, so that would be indicated by this last digit. Okay, so this is marking system for super abrasives. If you have any query, any doubt, either post it in chat window or unmute and speak. both cases are fine. I'll wait for a while so that you can ask your queries, or else I'll proceed to the next slide. So if you have any doubt, any query, let me know. Okay. Anybody else? Okay. Let's continue with the types of bonds. In the designation system, we saw that if it is made up of conventional abrasive, these are the types of bonds that would be available. If these are the super abrasives, then these bonds are going to be there. Now, this resinoid and vitrified bond you can find in both the types of abrasives. You can see resinoid is there and vitrified is there. And in case of super abrasive, resinoid and vitrified is there. The change is only metal bond. You don't find metal bond in case of conventional abrasives, and you get it only in super abrasives. Okay, so let's begin with the vitrified bond. This word vitrified is quite familiar to us, because if you look at the any advertise of the tiles that are used in flooring or in toilet and all, those tiles are marketed in the name of vitrified tiles. You might have seen that, right? So vitrified is type of bond that is used in those tiles. So what we do to get the vitrified bond, we take feldspar and clay, we mix it with the abrasive material, and after forming that combination into desired shape, we heat it to a temperature of 1250 degrees Celsius. When you heat it to that much higher temperature, what will happen? This feldspar and clay will melt and it will form a glass-like structure. It appears like a glass. And we know that because it appears like a glass, and glass is a type of ceramic, so this bond is also called as ceramic bond, because it appears like a glass. Okay. When you use this vitrified bond, it has got certain characteristics. The characteristics are like, the vitrified bonds are more strong, more stiff, and they provide better porosity. Now, porosity requires for the dissipation of heat as well as chip formation mechanism. So depending upon the application, this porosity also plays an important role, and vitrified bonds are going to have these characteristics. Additionally, because of the nature of that vitrified bond, it has got some specific applications. What are the applications? If that grinding wheel is going to be used in a scenario where oils, acids and water are going to be in contact with the grinding wheel. If oil is going to be in contact with the grinding wheel, acid is there or water is there, these kind of conditions could be easily handled with the help of vitrified bonds. Okay, so if that working environment or working condition is going to be have these three, you can go for the vitrified bonds. But it has got certain limitations as well. What are the limitations? These bonds are brittle in nature, and obviously if it is brittle, it is going to have less resistance to mechanical and thermal shock. If there is instant mechanical force or instantaneous temperature difference, then these bonds are going to fail. So that are the limitations of those vitrified bonds. These are brittle and having less resistance to mechanical and thermal shocking. So in that case, if you want to improve the bond strength, we can provide some additional support to those grinding wheels using the steel backing plates or cups that you can see over here. This is one of the advertise published by this Micro. It is actually manufacturer of the vitrified bonds or these grinding wheels. And you can see this layer is the grinding layer and it is supported by this plate like structure or disc like structure, which is of metal. Why do we do this one? Because these wheels are prone to failure when you expose them to instantaneous mechanical or thermal loading. And to avoid that failure, we provide that extra support with the help of those metal plates and discs. Okay, so these are the, or this is all about the vitrified bonds. In this advertise, you can take a look afterwards by pausing the video and all. You will find the various applications and various characteristics of the vitrified bond. Next, resinoid. When the bonding material is a thermosetting resin, it is basically a polymer or plastic. We know that there are few types: thermoset, thermoplastic, and elastomers. So out of that, if binding material is a thermosetting resin, for example, here is a phenolic resin. So wheel making procedure is going to be same. Take a raw material, add that raw material to the bonding material, that is phenolic resin, form into the desired shape, and then heat it to a certain temperature. In case of resinoid bond, that heating range is 175 degrees Celsius. It is a plastic polymer, so range is going to be quite low. So when you heat it to 175 degrees Celsius, the mixture will form bonding with the abrasive materials and it will provide the final strength. The additional characteristic of the resinoid bond is these are more flexible compared to the vitrified wheels. So if application makes it mandatory to have some flexibility in the grinding wheel, then resinoid is the choice. It would not be that flexible, but compared to vitrified, it would be a little bit more flexible. If you use rubber bond, that is going to have maximum flexibility, but compared to vitrified, resinoid has got some more flexibility. Next is reinforced wheel. Now, from the word reinforced, or what opinion do we have? Reinforced means it has got some additional strength. So when you make a reinforced wheel, what we do, suppose this is initial diameter of the grinding wheel, I will apply some reinforcement layer over here. Above that, I will add the another layer of abrasives and binding material. Then one layer of reinforcement, then one layer of abrasives and binding material. Okay, so that way wheels are made in terms of layers. That reinforcement will be provided with the help of fiberglass. Now, usually what do we think? We think that reinforcement means additional strength. But in case of grinding wheels, this reinforcement has some different role to play. What role it plays? Suppose this is actual grinding wheel. It has got some abrasives here and there, and you have started using it to grind some work surface. Suppose after a certain time, all the abrasives are gone from this outer layer. So usually what do we expect? We expect that once one abrasive is gone, it should log out of the surface and there should be removal of some layer from the wheel surface as well. Okay, that's what we expect. Now in case of reinforced wheel, what will happen? We know that this wheel is made up of one layer of reinforcement, then one layer of abrasives and binding material, then one layer of reinforcement. So in case of reinforced wheels, when all the abrasives from the wheel surface are gone, this one layer of reinforcement will be logged out of the grinding wheel. So that whole layer of reinforcement will be taken off from the grinding wheel. So what will happen? You will get a complete new surface of the wheel that has got maximum number of abrasives all over the surface, because what we have done, we have removed one complete layer of the grinding wheel. That was combination of that reinforcement. So the purpose of providing reinforcement in case of grinding wheels is to remove one layer at once to have fresh abrasives that are going to remove the material further. Next is thermoplastic. Just like thermosetting resins, you can use the thermoplastics also. So manufacturing process is going to be same. Thermoplastic material, mix with the abrasive and then heat it to a certain temperature so that have the final strength. Then next is rubber. As I mentioned, when the flexibility has to be maximum, in that case, you can go for the rubber as a bonding material. It is going to be most flexible matrix because it is rubber, right? And manufacturing process is same. Take the raw material of the rubber, like crude rubber, then mix it with the additives like sulfur and all, then form into a desired shape and then heat it. In case of rubber, that heating to get the finer properties, the process is called as vulcanization. You might have heard about that word, vulcanization of the rubber. So usually it would be vulcanized to have the final strength. And if you talk about the specific application of the rubber as a bonding material, the wheels are used as a saws. A thin disc would be made up of that bonding plus abrasive, bonding material plus abrasives, and that disc will be used to cutting off operations. When you want to remove some part from the work surface, simply cut it from the work surface, then rubber will be the choice. And last one is the metal. The manufacturing process would be powder metallurgy. Take a metal powder, add binding materials, add abrasives, shape into desired size and dimensions, and then heat it to a certain temperature so that bonding material will melt, form bond with the abrasives, and you will get the final strength. The metal bonded wheels are generally made up of materials like aluminium, bronze, steel, etc., depending upon the strength and characteristics required. And we know that metal bond is used in case of super abrasives only, that is CBN and diamond. And we know that those two are costly one. So usually the wheels made up of metal are going to be having layers, right? As we saw in the wheel marking system, that initial part will be made up of metal, then there would be layers of the abrasive plus bonding material. Why? Because of the cost only. Because if abrasives are there in till the minimum diameter, we know that after a certain diameter, the use will not be feasible, and we need to discard that wheel, and that will not be affordable in all these scenarios. So, and to avoid that, that is made in terms of layers. So that's all about the bonding materials. Now the next thing that we are going to talk about, the wheel grade and structures. This one is also we have discussed, so I will go through this one quickly. Wheel grade, again, whether it is a soft wheel or hard wheel, that we have discussed. And second, structure, that is whether wheel is dense or open. Now this softness or hardness, as I said, this softness or hardness is nothing, or this has nothing to do with the abrasives. Means if I am using alumina, still I can make soft wheel as well as hard wheel, because the softness or hardness is not about the abrasive, but this is about the bonding material. Okay. Now additionally, type of bonding material as well as the amount of binding material also decides whether wheel is hard or soft. So I can get a hard wheel either by choosing a hard bonding material, as well as if I use a large amount of that binding material, still I can get a hard wheel. So if amount of binding material is more, wheel will be hard, or by characteristic itself, if bonding material is hard, still you can get the hard wheel. And same scenario will be there for soft wheels. If binding material is less, wheel will be soft, or if binding material is soft one or having less strength, then that wheel will be soft one. Okay. Any doubt in this one? Okay. Next, structure. Structure is going to vary between dense and open. If large number of abrasives are there, structure is dense. If small number of abrasives are there, structure is open. We have discussed this one in details, which structure is to be preferred, dense one or open one. Each one of those has got its own limitations as well as advantages. Okay, so this is all about the wheel and structure, wheel grade and structure. Now we are going to talk about the grinding process. Before that, can any one of you let me know what time do we have before end of the meeting, so that I'll decide whether should I go further or stop here. Can you tell me what time it is showing? 15 minutes are there. Okay. So grinding process. Before discussing this one, I need to discuss something else. I'll end this slideshow for a while. Where is Google Chrome? Okay. As we are studying all these things online, is this Google Chrome window visible to each one of you? Can you see that manufacturing processes to Google Classroom page?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is a Google Classroom page that I have created for this MP2. If you go to classwork, you will find all the units that I already have created. You will find the notes of that individual unit in the PDF form. You can go to that notes section also, and you will get the notes in the PDF form. All the notes that I have created and are available in PDF form. Additionally, as now we have started the unit number 1, abrasive machining and finishing operations, you will get the notes, as well as there is one quiz that I already have created. Okay, so once you join this Google Classroom, you will be able to attempt that quiz. That quiz is based on lecture number 1, 2, and 3. The questions will not be based on unit lecture number 4, that is today's first session, but previous 3 sessions. So attempt this quiz as well. Additionally, if somehow, I'm not going to encourage this one, but still somehow, if you miss any of the session, I have in stream section, I have provided one YouTube channel link. If you click on that link, it will get you to the YouTube channel that has been created for this manufacturing processes too. You can see lecture number 1 and 2 is there. Lecture number 3 is also there. So you can take a look of those lectures as per your convenience also, but I'm not going to encourage that one, right? Or else you will start missing the regular lectures and using that YouTube only. That is not going to serve the purpose. Okay, but still, if you miss in any worst scenario, you can go and take a look of that one. Okay. Okay. Let me post the Google Classroom link where I can find it over here. Okay, so I just have posted the Google Classroom link. I'll post it in WhatsApp group as well. Use that one to join the Google Classroom. Additionally, I'll post that YouTube link as well. Okay, so those two links are there that you are supposed to use on a regular basis. Okay, we have 9 minutes in our hand. So let's continue to the presentation. Okay. Before that, any suggestion or any thing that you want from me that is going to help throughout the course of this MP2? Do you want any additional thing to be provided except those two, that Google Classroom, notes, everything is there? Most probably if examination to be conducted on MCQs, that is also fine, because on each or after every 2 or 3 lectures, I'll post one quiz on that Google Classroom that would be based on those 2-3 lectures, and that will help you to prepare for the semester examination also. So that I'll take care of. Anything additional you want from me or any suggestion is there, let me know. I have opened the chat window. You can put it in there also. Okay. Let's continue. Grinding process versus single point cutting tool. Now, before proceeding to the single point cutting tool, actual grinding process, what things are there that is going to make the grinding process different from the single point cutting tool? Because both are the examples of mechanical cutting, right? Both are going to have a physical contact between cutting tool and workpiece material. There is going to be relative motion between cutting tool and work material. Tool is going to be harder than work material, and that way there will be removal of unnecessary material from the work surface to get the desired product having desired characteristics. Still, single point cutting and grinding process are going to differ from each other. So what are the differences? So the differences are, in case of single point cutting tool, one point or single cutting edge will be active and that will remove the material. In case of grinding, instead of single cutting tool, there would be number of cutting tools acting together, and that number is going to be random. At any instant, you will not be able to figure out what number of cutting tools are in action or what number of abrasives are actually cutting the material. That is going to be very difficult to predict or identify. That is the first difference. Second, the individual abrasive that is going to be used as a cutting tool is going to have irregular shape, as well as it will be randomly placed on the grinding wheel. Even if I say this is, suppose, view that I have captured of the grinding wheel that has got one abrasive over here, one over here, one over here, one over here, and I started using that grinding wheel. Still, I cannot say that these six abrasives are there and going to take a part in actual cutting. Because suppose at the very beginning, this abrasive got dislocked. This abrasive got worn out and only those four took part in actual cutting, right? So that way the abrasives are going to be irregular shape and randomly spaced. They are going to be spaced anywhere on that grinding wheel. That is going to be complete randomization in terms of spacing. The next thing is rake angle. If you consider the single point cutting tool, this is vertical line, this is our cutting tool, this is cutting edge, and if you take angle of that cutting edge with the vertical, this is called as rake angle, denoted by alpha. If it is on this side of this vertical, it is positive, and if it is on this side of this vertical, it is negative. In case of single point cutting tool, it is always positive. But in case of abrasive, the abrasive is going to be like this one. This is grinding wheel. This is abrasive that is going to remove the material. So if you draw a vertical over here and try to identify the angle, that is going to be highly negative. So that is the second difference. In case of abrasive machining, the rake angle is going to be highly negative and it could be up to -60 also, or even less than that. That is the second difference. Now, because of this highly negative rake angle, there is going to be more plastic deformation of the chips. Means when that abrasive removes material from the work surface, it will not simply formation of chip and separation of that chip from the work surface instantaneously. That kind of scenario will not be there. This abrasive will deform the formed chip plastically to a large extent because of this negative rake angle. Okay, and because of this plastic deformation and all, there will be much more force or cutting force generation in case of grinding process. Next, the radial position of grains over the peripheral surface is varying. That we know, right? Abrasives are randomly spaced, they are having random shape, random position, random geometry and all. So that positions and all going to vary. And because of that one, whatever grind abrasives are there on the grinding wheel surface, all are not going to be active while the cutting. Few will be removing the material, few will be idle. Because if you look at the wheel surface, even if in this area, if this is one abrasive, this another abrasive, this is third one, this is fourth one, likewise. Now, when you remove material, those two, three may take part in cutting and the smaller one will remain idle. So at any instant, all the tools, all the abrasives are not going to be take part in cutting. And last one is, the grinding wheels are going to have a large surface speeds. That is, the rotational speed of the grinding wheel is usually very large. That is the another difference. Now, there is one question that you are supposed to Google it. Why surface speeds in grinding are very high? Okay, Google it and be ready with the answer for the next session. The meeting is about to end. So I'll stop right here. Any doubt, any query, you can contact me through all the possible means. We'll stop over here. Remember this question. Actually, I have answered already.